Welcome to the Creek Road Baptist Pulpit. These weekly podcasts feature expository messages delivered to edify the soul. Now let's join Pastor Dave as he presents this week's message. So Exodus chapter 10 today. We're going to begin in verse 1. We're going to read through verse 20 today, but we'll do that a little piece at a time. We'll read verses 1 and 2 to start with, and then just keep your Bible open because we'll be reading the verses as I go through and make comment. This is a long passage. This is the sign of the locust, and I've entitled this message, An Army Invades Egypt. And so here they come. Just begin then with our reading in verses 1 and 2. And the Lord said unto Moses, Go in unto Pharaoh, for I have hardened his heart and the heart of his servants, that I might show these my signs before him, and that thou mayest tell in the ears of thy son and thy son's son what things I have wrought in Egypt and my signs which I have done among them, that ye may know that I am the Lord. So far we've seen the majority of the signs. We come to this now, the eighth or the ninth, depending on how you count the signs, of the signs here in Egypt, the judgments that God brought upon Pharaoh and the people, the land, against the gods of Egypt. We're learning something about Pharaoh, something different every single time we read this. I was reading a book yesterday by a fellow named Oakley Hall. He's a great teacher of writing, and he wrote a book, How Fiction Works. And in that book, he said this. He's writing about the short story, and he says, In a good short story, the characters are revealed through the action, and the action is controlled through the characters. Boy, and if that doesn't tell us our experience with Pharaoh so far, I don't know what does. He goes on and he says, The challenge of the short story writer is to make the action describe or reveal as many of the secrets of the existence as possible. So we're learning about the heart. Remember, the heart is the thing that's always in view here in these signs. It's the heart of Pharaoh, or, as we'll see today, the heart of his people. Also in view. Well, we actually saw it last time. We'll see it again a little bit more today. So we come to the meeting, beginning here in verse 1. The Lord said unto Moses, Go in unto Pharaoh, for I have hardened his heart and the heart of his servants. See, the hardness now is spreading. Notice that the servants are being hardened. And, of course, these must be the ones who, in the last sign, didn't listen. Remember, there were some of the folks of Egypt who listened to the word of the Lord, they hearkened to the word of the Lord, and they brought in all of their people and all their animals so that the hail wouldn't kill them. Those who wouldn't, who refused to hearken to the word of the Lord, they just let them out there in the field because they didn't think God was going to do anything. And then, of course, he did. So the hardening has begun now in the hearts of the people. These didn't listen to the word of the Lord. Probably in the hail sign are the ones that are being mentioned here. I've hardened his heart and the heart of his servants. It's always the word of God that does this hardening work, especially when we resist it. Be careful of resisting God's word. He goes on to say, that I might show these signs before him. Now the Lord is using Pharaoh as his instrument to show his power. And he's doing quite a marvelous job of that. He's done things that are global in scale, that are so completely overwhelming that only God could do them. We're coming upon another sign, not this week, but next, the sign of darkness, that people try to make it a natural phenomenon. Oh, well, this could happen, and so forth. Nonsense. None of these could happen. Not like they're described to us. This is God alone. He goes on, he says, that thou mayest tell in the ears of thy son and thy son's son what things I have wrought in Egypt and my signs which I have done among them. Now, what in the world's happened here? It's almost like we've had a shift now. We've been all about Pharaoh and his heart and the hardening of his heart and the continual mercy that God has demonstrated towards him and the mercy that God has been demonstrating towards the children of Israel in these last several signs by not allowing them to affect the Israelites at all, the Hebrews. So now he says, I'm doing this and I'm using Pharaoh in this way so that, and then notice what he says, you might tell in the ears of your son and the ears of your grandsons what things I have wrought in Egypt and my signs which I have done among them. The establishment of this teaching moment is one that will last into the future. And actually, ladies and gentlemen, from the time that the Lord said this to Moses in Exodus chapter 10 until this very day, we are retelling all that the Lord has done. Every sign, every miracle, every work that declares His Godhead and power and glory, we continue to tell those stories. Up into the New Testament, with the Lord Jesus and all that He did and all that He healed and all that He helped, and then His great sacrifice on the cross and the resurrection of Him from the dead and the salvation that comes to the church, we've been telling that entire grand story for generations. We still tell it. And who do we tell it to? Who is the first person we want to tell it to? Our children. We want them to know, don't we? Tell it to your son. Tell it to your son's sons, that they may know all that I've wrought in Egypt, my signs that I have done among them. Oh, what we do today is to declare the power of the Lord and His providence over all nations and over all peoples. This is the reason why you teach there at the end of that passage, verse 2, that you might know that I am the Lord. We understand that He wants Pharaoh to know that He is the Lord, and He wants Pharaoh to bow his knee. But this, ladies and gentlemen, goes for the Hebrews as well. They're not exempt from this lesson. The Lord wants the Hebrew children to know, the sons and the grandsons and all the present folk and all the old folk and all the young folk and every folk in that Hebrew camp. He wants them to know that He is the Lord. So why do we teach? Why do we have Sunday school? Why do we have a sermon every week? Twice on Sunday, and then why do we have lessons on Wednesday night, and why do we have lessons at other times of the year? Why do we do that? Why are we constantly teaching the Word? Because we want everyone to know that He is the Lord. You look throughout the entirety of the Scripture, in all the revelation, Old Testament and New, and that's why we do this, so that we might know that He is the Lord. This is not for the Egyptians only, this is not for Pharaoh only, but it is also for the children of Israel. And by extension, I think we can say it's for the church too. We are to learn this lesson because it's the same God. It's the same Godhead. It's the same power. It's the same eternal hand. It's the same outstretched arm. By an outstretched arm and a mighty hand, He released the children of Israel from Egypt, and by an outstretched arm and by a mighty hand, He has delivered us from the captivity of sin. Verse 3, Moses and Aaron came in unto Pharaoh and said, "Thus saith the Lord God of the Hebrews." I love their boldness. They just walk right in there. Let's not mince words. Let's not have chit-chat. Let's tell you exactly what's going on here. Here's what God says. And now I want you to notice this sequence, because we're going to see it twice. Once here with Moses and Aaron, and then once with Pharaoh's servants. So notice, first thing, how long will you refuse to humble yourself before me? That's the question God asks Pharaoh. Because Pharaoh's heart is the thing. He wants Pharaoh desperately to bow before him. And he says to him, how long will you refuse? Usually that's our question to the Lord, isn't it? Don't we ask Him that question? Lord, I've been asking You for this for 15 years. How long, O Lord? Right? We get tired of asking. We get tired. But don't you know that He gets tired too? How long are you going to resist the gospel message? How long are you going to revel in your own pride? How long are you going to revel in your own strength? What's it going to take? And so He comes to Pharaoh with that very question. He looks at Pharaoh. What's it going to take? How long are you going to resist? How long will you refuse to humble yourself? This is what the Lord wants from every man. And then the command. And we know this command, and Pharaoh knows this command. We could probably cite this command from memory. Let my people go, that they may serve me. I don't think that we need to make much comment more about that. Although, I will say, I have yet, and the Lord keeps putting this niggling little thing in the back of my mind, I have not yet explored with you this idea of His propriety over His people. And so we're going to talk about that, not today, but probably next week or the week after. his propriety over his people. And so we'll talk about that upcoming. So we have the question, we have the command, and then we have tomorrow. Again, we have tomorrow. Else, he says, if thou refuse to let my people go, behold, tomorrow will I bring the locust into thy coast. How come he doesn't give him an ultimatum right now? Because God's mercy is long-suffering. He is waiting for Pharaoh to turn. To do what? To humble himself before him. What a wonderful thing that God is asking for Pharaoh to do, just like he's asking every one of us. The catechism this morning alludes to that, right? We're to come before him humbly, exhorting him for whatever we ask. If you refuse to let my people go, behold, tomorrow I will bring the locust into thy coasts. The mercy of the Lord is once again seen and offered to Pharaoh. Notice verse 4, the language there, else if thou refuse. Now, he's already used that very word there in verse 3, how long will you refuse? But that is to humble yourself. And here is, if you refuse to send out the children of Israel, to let the people go, then tomorrow, mercy, I'm going to bring locusts upon your coast. He could have brought them right then, right? But no, God gives him a chance. Remember, this is the timeline that Pharaoh sets in the plague of the frogs. When Moses goes in and asks him, when do you want these frogs gone? Pharaoh says, tomorrow. And then all the tomorrows start piling up. Every time the Lord comes in with Moses and Aaron, the Lord says to Pharaoh through Moses and Aaron, tomorrow this will happen. So Pharaoh's got a tomorrow. And you're going to see that there's things that happen in the interim here. So we're going to get a little peek into that time between when Moses and Aaron speak and when the plague actually occurs. And then notice, the Lord describes what's going to happen, beginning there in verse 5. And they shall cover the face of the earth, that one cannot be able to see the earth. And they shall eat the residue of that which is escaped, which remaineth unto you from the hail, and shall eat every tree which groweth for you out of the field. And they shall fill thy houses, and the houses of thy servants, and the houses of all the Egyptians, which neither thy fathers nor thy fathers' fathers have seen since the day that they were upon the earth unto this day. And he turned himself and went out from Pharaoh. So, Pharaoh knows when it's going to happen, Pharaoh knows what is going to happen, and he knows how the what is going to happen. It's going to happen tomorrow, and it's going to be this bad. They will cover the face of the earth. You won't be able to see the ground. Haven't we had enough of that yet? We had that with the frogs, we had that with the flies, we have it now with the locusts. This is gross. There's that many locusts that the ground is covered with them. Now, this locust is probably about 2.5 inches. It's about like that. And it's got a four-inch wingspan, so 2.5 inches long, the body of it, about a four-inch wingspan. And you can imagine that many of those critters on everything, covering the ground so that you can't see the earth. You can't see the tree any longer because the tree is just one big clump of locusts. Not only do they cover every single stitch of every single thing in creation in the entire land of Egypt. Now remember, again, this is near global in scale because we're talking about that entire Nile Valley from the Mediterranean all the way down south till you get to Khartoum. That entire valley, thousands of miles. These locusts covered the whole thing. This isn't just like two blocks, right? This isn't four city blocks that they covered. No. This is the entire land and everybody in them, because it says they shall eat the residue of that which is escaped. And of course, we've all seen that, at least personally, or we've seen stories and pictures of what happens when a locust bloom takes place. They consume every green thing. They shall eat the trees which grow for you out of the field. And that many locusts coming that hungry? Not only that, but then they do something that is really unheard of because they go into the houses. Notice there in 6, they shall fill thy houses, the houses of thy servants, the houses of all the Egyptians. They're everywhere. There's nothing green in the houses, but they're in there anyway. Oh, you can't escape them. They're all over the place. And then he says this, which we've seen before also, haven't we? We saw this with the flies. We've seen this with the murrain. We've seen this with the fine powder that happened from the ash and the boils that were. It just covers every single thing, and the hail. It had never been seen before. Well, here we have that very kind same thing here. Your fathers nor your fathers' fathers have seen since the day they were upon the earth unto this day. It has never happened that there's been a locust plague this bad. Of course, because who's doing this? The Lord's doing this. So if you go back to the plague of the hail, there were certain things that were destroyed, the flax and the barley. But the wheat and the rye were still tender. And so they survived the hail. And so you still have a little bit there. Most of the trees were destroyed in the hail, but anything that was left over from the hail, now the locusts are going to come in, and the locusts are going to eat all the trees that are left. They're going to eat up all the wheat, and they're going to eat up all the rye. There's not going to be any foods left to the Egyptians. They've lost everything. They lost all their cattle. They've lost all their flax, all their textiles. They've lost all their barley, wheat, and rye. They're going to now. And so they're done. I mean, they are completely done. The land stinks because of the frogs. The river stinks because of the blood. The land has been ruined because of the flies. And now here comes the locust. And anything good and green that's left, gone. Now that's the warning. The Lord says, tomorrow this will happen. Okay. And then as I said, they give that and then they turn and they walk out. No repartee with Pharaoh. Now notice verse 7. Here's where we have something different. This is that interim between when Moses and Aaron make the announcement and when the plague actually comes. And here's that interim period. Pharaoh's servants said unto him. So now the argument of Pharaoh's servants followed the same pattern as the Lord's words to Pharaoh. Notice the question. The question in the first piece in verse 3 was, how long will you refuse to humble yourself before me? Look at verse 7. Pharaoh's servant said unto him, how long shall this man be a snare to us? Well, we know the answer, don't we? Until Pharaoh humbles himself. Now here's the command. The command in verse 3 was, let my people go that they may serve me. We know that. Pharaoh knows that. Everybody knows that command. Here's the command of the servants of Pharaoh, they say to him, let the men go. Wow. They're talking to Pharaoh. He's a god. And these people serve the god in the land. He is the incarnation of one of the chief gods in their pantheon. And they look at him and they say, let the men go. And notice their language. They get kind of snippy with him here. That they may serve the Lord God. Don't you know that Egypt is destroyed? Somebody needed to do, you know, we had, what do you call that? An intervention. This is an intervention. They come in after Moses and Aaron leave and they sit down with him and look. How long are these guys going to be a problem? You need to let the men go. Don't you yet know? Egypt is destroyed. So, the third part of the little piece, God gives the question, he gives the command, and then he says, tomorrow. Well, here we have the question, the command, and then we have don't let tomorrow come because he says, don't you know Egypt is destroyed? Now, this is apparently enough for Pharaoh to call him back. It says there in verse 8, Moses and Aaron were brought in again. The Hebrew language here suggests that they were returned, you know. That's a kind of a polite way of saying the servants went out and got Moses and Aaron and pulled them back in. They were returned, okay? So here Moses and Aaron are returned to Pharaoh. Now, who knows what was said to Moses and Aaron? Who knows what the servants did when they grabbed them and said, come on, you got to come back in here. But they brought them back in before Pharaoh. And notice here in verse 8, it's Pharaoh speaking. Moses and Aaron brought in unto Pharaoh, and he said to them, go serve the Lord your God. But who are they that shall go? Now, I want you to notice here, and I've done a little work with the language here, and I want to kind of explain some of this language, because it's a little bit confusing, so we'll try to straighten it all out. First thing he says, the first sentence here, is this is Pharaoh saying, go away. You go. Go serve the Lord your God. Okay? He doesn't want to do that. He doesn't want to say that. But his servants have basically put their foot down and said, you're going to let these guys go. Pharaoh says, go serve the Lord your God. But then as soon as he says that, we have this. And this is my translation. Who is it that shall go? So as soon as he says go, he immediately thinks, wait a minute, who's leaving? So we have who twice here in the text, who twice. Who but who is it that shall go? And then notice, I want you to notice the poetic sound here of Moses' reply. Moses is the one that speaks here. He says, with our young and with our old, we will go. With our sons and with our daughters, with our flocks and with our herds, will we go? For we must hold a feast unto the Lord. Moses must have just been ecstatic. He's like, yes, finally, we're going to leave. And all Pharaoh wanted to know who's going to go, so he just tells him, our young and our old, our flocks and our herds, we're all going to go, and we're going to have a feast to the Lord. And he's kind of, it's almost sing-songy, the way it's written. It's beautiful, actually, the way it's written. We will go, the verb that's used here for we will go appears twice, both times at the end of these lovely phrases, with our young and with our old, with our sons and with our daughters, with our flocks and with our herds, we will go, and we'll have a feast to the Lord our God. And then Pharaoh says to them, let the Lord be so with you as I will let you go, and your little ones look to it, for evil is before you. So you read that in verse 10, you think, is he really letting them go? What's he saying here? What's this about? So let me give you my translation. He said to them, may the Lord be so with you when I send you out. So he's pronouncing a blessing, but it's sort of a backhanded blessing. He says, yeah, may the Lord be with you when I send you out, but your children, it's a question. Watch out, because evil is headed your way. You see, what Pharaoh knew was that if they left their children, mom and dad are going to come back for the babies. But if the babies go with mom and dad, nobody's coming back. And Pharaoh can't have that. He says, so you better watch out. Evil is before you, which means my evil is before you. If you go with your children, your children, look out now. Evil is before you. Pharaoh's not going to let them go at all. And then verse 10 or verse 11, not so. Go now, ye that are men. Now that's exactly what the servants said to him. Notice back up there in verse 7, how long shall this man be a snare unto us? Let the men go. Very specifically. Now we've had people all along. The Lord said, let the people go. Moses or Pharaoh has said, I'll let the people go. Moses has commanded according to the word of the Lord, let the people go. Now the servants come in and they say, why don't you let the men go? And then Moses says, oh, we're going to go with our flocks and our herds and our old and our young and our sons and our daughters and blah, blah, blah. And then Pharaoh says, No, you that are men, you go and serve the Lord your God. For that you desire. Of course, they don't think that the children have any say in this. This is what mom and dad wants. Let mom and dad go. In this case, just the men. Let mamas have to stay home with them babies. Somebody's got to. So all the males of age, they can go and serve the Lord, for that's what you desire. And they were driven out from Pharaoh's presence. So I guess right then and there, Moses and all the male men, 20 years old and upward, they could have left Egypt and gone off into the wilderness 3 days and held a feast and taken all their flocks and all their herds, and moms and babies had to stay home. Of course, that's not the deal. That's not what God has commanded them. He said, let my people go. not let just the men go. Pharaoh's up against it. And we have to understand the wrinkle that he's found himself in. Egypt is destroyed. And Pharaoh thinks it can be recovered. And they have nothing left. And after this plague, they will have nothing left. I mean, zero. But Egypt learned the lesson of Joseph. And they understood what it meant to put away for a rainy day. And all those grain silos and all that reserve that they had, that agricultural reserve that they had during Joseph's time, they learned that lesson. And so they still had that. And now, even though all the wheat and all the flax and all the barley and all the rye is gone, is going to be gone, and all the fruit trees is going to be gone after the locusts are come through, Pharaoh still thinks that he can recover the land because he has a stockpile of seed. And of course, what's going to happen every year in Egypt? That Nile is going to come back, and it's going to flood the land, and they're going to plant, and they've got plenty of seed. But what they need to do that is labor. So Pharaoh thinks, I can recover this land, it can be restored the way it was, but I have to have people to do it. And he had 400 plus years with the Israelites, and thousands of years before that with slave labor. They had worked the fields, they had worked in their construction yards, they had worked in the brick kilns. They knew how to do it, but they knew how to do it with the labor that they had. So Pharaoh's still thinking, I've got to have these guys. I cannot let them go. They cannot leave, because if they leave, Egypt surely is destroyed. Because there's no way I can do it without the labor piece. And so he says to them, the men can go, the children have to stay. Then you'll come back. And then, well, I'll be a happy family again. You get what you want, I'll get what I want. But see, that's not the way the Lord works, is it? The Lord's going to have his way because he's sovereign over kingdoms, nations, and the world. And then the Lord sends the sign there in verse 12. The Lord said to Moses, stretch out thine hand over the land of Egypt for the locusts, that they may come upon the land of Egypt to eat every herb of the land, even all that the hail hath left. Moses stretched forth his rod over the land of Egypt. The Lord brought an east wind upon the land all that day and all that night. And when it was morning, the east wind brought the locust. And the locust went up over all the land of Egypt and rested in all the coasts of Egypt. Very grievous were they. Before them there was no such locust as they, neither after them shall be such. That word grievous is very much like the word that we translated with the flies, burdensome. Heavy. There's just too much of it. Grievous. It was more than they could stand. And then notice verse 15. For they covered the face of the whole earth so that the land was darkened. Now here we have another description of what happened. Not only could you not see the ground, but it was made dark. There was no reflection off the ground from the sunshine. The locust, the body of the locust soaked up all the sun. So there was no reflection from the ground. There was no sight of the sky because the locusts filled the sky. They're flying everywhere. It's like a cloud that's moving. And it's on everything. They don't sit still. The land was darkened by them. Of course, this is preparing them for the next sign, isn't it? And they did eat every herb of the land and all the fruit of the trees which the hail had left. So they've stripped now everything off these trees and off the ground. And there remained not any green thing in the trees or in the herbs of the field through all the land of Egypt. Now remember, we're not talking about a city block or a cityscape. We're talking about thousands of miles of Nile Valley completely covered by locusts, eating everything. Now if they come into my yard and they just my weeds, I'm good with that. If they just eat the weeds. But they didn't. They ate the weeds. They ate the seeds. They ate the green stuff I want to keep. They ate the stuff that's producing my food. They ate the fruit off the trees. They ate the leaves off the trees. They stripped the bark off the trees. They ate everything. Eating is what locusts do. And then notice verse 16. This devastation. I mean, this devastation. Actually, the language of the servants describes it best. They said, don't you know yet that Israel is destroyed. That word destroys is a battle term. It means utterly devastated, completely gone, burned to the ground, broken, and beat down. That's the idea here. And now it is. Pharaoh, verse 16, calls for Moses and Aaron in haste, and he said, I have sinned. Wow. Against the Lord your God and against you. No, what a great confession that is. I have sinned, he says, against the Lord your God and against you. He sinned against the Lord by rebelling against the command, and he sinned against Moses by the way he has treated Moses and Aaron. Well, look at verse 17. Now therefore, forgive, I pray thee, my sin only this once, and entreat the Lord your God that he may take away from me this death only. Notice the word only there twice. He's concerned that God take the bad stuff, right? Take the bad stuff away. This is my sin. Forgive my sin, my rebellion, and take this death away. Only this death. Notice that there's nothing here about his heart. There's nothing here about him humbling himself before the Lord. We think it sounds good. I've sinned against you and against the Lord. Forgive, I pray thee, my sin. Yes, he says it twice. And he asks for forgiveness, but it's forgiveness for this only. It's forgiveness for this death only. Take away this death only from me. Forgive this sin only, this once. Not the rest of it. Not the rebellion that began back in chapter 5. Not the rebellion that continued in chapter 6. Not the rebellion of chapter 7. Not the rebellion in chapter 8. Not the rebellion in chapter 9. No. This one's bad, though. This one. And he went out from Pharaoh, Moses did, and entreated the Lord. What a faithful man of God. Even though I imagine that Moses had some idea that Pharaoh wasn't going to do anything. Or maybe he hoped that he would. Maybe he hoped that this was it. This confession, this was good enough. That this is where Pharaoh was. He had met the Lord finally in this moment. And Moses goes out. And he does exactly what Pharaoh's asked him to do. He entreats the Lord for him. But let me ask you a question. Why couldn't Pharaoh have done this? Why couldn't Pharaoh have bowed himself, gotten down off his gilded throne, got on his knees, taken off his crown, and bowed his head before the Lord God of heaven and said, Father, forgive me? How come he had asked Moses for this? He didn't. You know the answer to that question, don't you? So he went out from Pharaoh and entreated the Lord, and the Lord turned a mighty strong west wind. And we had the east wind bring in the locusts, so they come in from the sea area, and now the west wind comes in off that Sahara Desert that borders right up against that Nile River Valley. And now that hot west wind comes in and drives the locusts out. The locusts didn't want any part of that hot west wind, and they all are now pushed out. And it says, he took away the locust and cast them into the Red Sea. Don't you know the bass had a feast that day? All of them in the Red Sea. Yeah, the bass were praising the Lord on that day. And notice the very next phrase there. There remained not one. Have we seen that before? Absolutely. Not a fly was left. Remember that? Not one. Not a frog was left. Not one. He keeps mentioning that. Not one of the Hebrews' cattle was hurt in the moraine. Not one. Here it is again. There remained not one locust in all the coast of... You mean to tell me they couldn't find one? But see, that's how thoroughly God does a thing. We saw his thorough hand and his mighty outstretched arm as they came in and ate everything. And now we see his mighty hand and his outstretched arm when he removes. See, this is the mercy of God, isn't it? He pushes everything out. He doesn't leave one. And you know what? When you come to faith in Christ Jesus, God takes your sin, and you know what he does with it? Pushes it out into the Red Sea. Let the bass have that. And there's not one sin left, because the blood of Jesus avails for every single sin in your life. He doesn't leave one! Don't you tell me there's one left. Oh, yeah, you might struggle with sin. But friend, the blood of Jesus has redeemed you completely. Not one. Not one. All the locusts in the coasts of Egypt, not one left. Because that's how thorough God is. He completely takes care of that. But, it says there in verse 20, oh, we don't like these, do we? Here's our but. The Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart so that he would not let the children of Israel go. And how does his heart get hard? His heart gets hard because he hears the word of the Lord and he rebels against it. If you want a science experiment to see how to harden a human heart, there it is. Add rebellion and the word of God together, you'll get a hard heart. I hope that that's not happening to someone you know. If it is, you need to pray for them. And perhaps if you're hearing the word of the Lord for the first time today, and you know it's talking to you, you know he wants you to ask for forgiveness. You know he wants you to confess your sin. You know he wants you to bow your knee. And the Lord's asking that question, I think, of someone today. How long will you refuse to humble thyself before me? Oh my. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for us to bow the knee before the Lord.
Jesus will meet you.
Thanks for listening to this week's message. Please join us again next time for another installment of the Creek Road Baptist Pulpit.